Hey guys, so welcome back. This example here, I'm picking up where I left off. This was with the set extension here, and as you can see, we started with sort of a picture here in portrait orientation, and I just sort of extended it so that we could throw in like a sea monster or something, but we had to make the space here a little bigger. In addition, like in the last video, we talked about sort of extending the sky. I went over this little thing here with the clouds. I'm not quite done with this yet, but being in sort of an educational video, I think you guys get more or less get the point. I've replicated some of these clouds here from here, and then I recreated these from scratch just using one of these brushes here. So you press B for brush. You can see something that's really, really handy is this this soft round brush that gives you all sorts of uses for this here. And in this particular use, I made a cloud, let's call it a cloud particle out of it. And then I'm just sort of tone, just stacking it, turning down the transparency and stacking it over the other pieces, and gradually you can get this sort of this very very cool sort of abstract mass. So it's good for clouds, steam, and all sorts of stuff, which is really great. Not in this example. This is kind of a more or less a bland example as these things go. But for if you had like more of a background and things sort of receding into the background. This is cool because you can sort of weave between foreground and background elements with this this sort of trick here. So anyway, I wanted to create a sea monster. So that's what this video here is about. And I want to sort of apologize in advance, or not apologize, but sort of warn you in advance that this is going to be more or less a long video and there's not, I don't exactly have a formula of doing this. And much like when you guys try this out, you guys are going to discover the same thing. You're just going to have to experiment with different things. And that's, you know, that's part of it. That's part of the thing. It's kind of, it's art, you know, and it's visual, and you're just going to have to experiment to see what works and stuff. So let me see. Last time I did this here, I had some different pieces of things that I wanted to use, and I have that still here somewhere. Yeah, you know what? I'm not going to. Oh yeah, there we go. So this guy, this is the thing I was using to create my sea monster. Before I start with anything here, too, I just want to show you. Let's just pull that up here. Here, so if I bring that up, there we go. So this is the thing we're going to use to create or sea monster. In addition, just looking around, I found some other things. But let me show you where I started out from. And just once again, I just really want to emphasize this here. As for you know, this is my starting point, and this is a quick little drawing here that I did on some paper lying around my desk, and you know, I'm just sort of sketching it to see what I'm thinking of as far as a sea monster here, and just as I envisioned it here, I'd have this. All sorts of these really sort of thorny, weird teeth, like those really sort of those weird under, what do you call them, those deep sea creatures. I'm thinking of like an angler fish or something. And so I actually looked them up here. Let's pull that up. Angler fish. Right? Yeah, and that's what these things look like here. And I thought, you know, it'd be kind of cool to have this, you know, this stuff here. This is kind of how I envision my sea monster teeth and stuff. And I'm not sure sometimes if we're looking at like CG or if we're looking at real things. But in any case, so I took some examples of that. But in truth, I found it. I found some kind of other things here that were kind of interesting, such as what do you call those things? Moray eels, moray eel, right? The hair, this guy. I mean, look at that. And this guy isn't even all that big and stuff. But I mean, look, he's really scary looking, you know. And so I got some pictures of this that I think I'm going to use to do the teeth. In any case, that's my thinking here. Maybe for this, I haven't actually done the tried this yet, but I kind of imagined how it would go. You know, for some reason here. I might want like these big scales and armored plates sort of on his chest and on the neck here. You can see I sort of drew in just some idea of the surface here that I want on him here. And you don't see this on this picture here, but because it's cut off. But what I wrote down here is like, you know, there's a sort of a scaled texture. And then I thought about it after a while, and you know, and I changed my mind because it's kind of interesting. Like, would a creature that big actually have really visible scales? You know, do those scales, you know, do they grow proportionately with the size of the creature, or do they maintain sort of a sort of a small size? And just like my thinking here, I don't know if I'm right or wrong, but my thinking it was just like they're smaller scales, and this thing would appear to be sort of more like rubbery at a distance. It would be appear to be more like rubbery than scaly. So I changed my mind with that, and I went with something more like, you know, something more simple here. So let's take this thing here for starters here. And just like in the previous video, I'm going to cut this out, and we can do this in using some different ways here. So obviously, you know, a lot of people talk about using this trick here, which is the lasso tool, and that's fine. You can, but I don't feel like I have a lot of control of it here. And I, you know, even going sort of carefully here, and I can go back and we can add. So if I press like shift. You can see there's a little plus sign now next to my cursor, and that it got a little better, but it also got a little worse here because I kind of missed here, and that's just the nature of sort of working with a mouse. Oh, and by the way, if you are not working with a mouse, then just go get one. You know, it's just gonna make things so much more comfortable for you. You're gonna have more precision, and you know what? Even if you do have like a fancy drawing tablet. There's a certain sort of precision that comes from working with a mouse, so you want to have one of those around. It's not going to be really all that expensive, and it is in no way can you substitute a trackpad for a mouse. You know, it's just really, really different. You get a much better experience with the mouse. So long story short, you know, if you want to, you know, I don't mean to sound like this, but if you want to be taken seriously, you know, or if you want to make some decent art, I think get yourself something that allows you to do that. You know, at the minimum, just get some cheap mouse that lets you work with the proper commands. So that being said, you know, I do reference a lot of like click, you know, right clicking and things like that are accessible in the menus. So you have that with the mouse as well. If you have a fancy drawing tablet such as the Wacom or something like that, let me see if I can pull this up here. So. Yeah, so mine isn't plugged in, but the nice thing about the Wacom is you can program in the buttons on one of those tablets, and so you can have it act as if it were some of the buttons on the mouse. So that's an advantage here. You know, there's a lot of advantages to working with mice and pens too. You know, if you're into painting and stuff, or like touching up this. I guess you can call this painting in a way, and you'll see why in a second here. But all right, so this is my way of selecting this here, and I'm going to use the pen tool. You can get that by selecting this little icon here or pressing P, like the little animation suggests. And if you watch the little videos there that play as you hover over the tool, it kind of suggests what it does here. And what the pen tool is all about, it's a vector tool that creates these really smooth transitions here using all these little points here. And the nice thing about this is you can always go back and correct the shape that you made. So you don't need to worry too much about precision. Let's try that out here. So I'm gonna take this, I'm gonna start from here, and we'll click a little point here. And I'm actually gonna be very, very minimal in the amount of points that I laid down here. So a lot of beginners will try to get this shape by doing this and just sort of connecting the dots here. And I think that's kind of missing the whole point of what the pen tool actually does. I mean, being a vector tool here, the advantage of using, you know, vectors versus pixels is that you know, if I zoom in enough to a pixel image, you're going to start seeing little squares. Whereas with a vector tool, you know, all it is, it's a point in space, and you're defining sort of the profile of that curve. And so no matter how far or how close you are, it's the same shape. You know, so that's what's really great about vectors, and what makes them ideal for things like logo design and things like that. And not to mention when you have something like a sort of a smooth shape here, then you can use the pen tool to sort of cut things out. And I think it's really, really ideal for all sorts of things in Photoshop as well. So anyway, let's cut this guy out here. So rather than doing all those little points, what I think I would rather do here is just take one here. I bet I can just put one right here just to use that as kind of the bend. Now, instead of just clicking and letting go, I'm going to hold this down, and instead of letting go, I'm going to pull. When I pull, you see I get this this little point here, and it stretches out the profile here to give us this sort of this arch here in the back. And you know, and when I draw my next point, it's going to project out this way here. So I'm just going to come down here, and you see, if we zoom in here, here's what's cool about the pen tool, and especially as you work, you know, I can define these things right from the get-go here. So in here, I've got this little point here, and I kind of missed a little bit here, but it's no big deal, because I'm going to press the Alt key, and if I hover over one of these little handles here, they call them the Bezier handles, and that's just sort of like a, let's call it like the extension of the curve. If you hover over here, you can just pull that back like so, and you see that's got that nice curve. And I can continue drawing now from here, and it's got that nice sharp sort of profile that we wanted, you know. What about here? You know, I want to reverse the direction of this. No big deal. I just press Alt, hover over this, it becomes a little V, and pull that little V out like this way here. And, you know, if we really wanted to get really into this, I could trace around it here. Yeah, I guess I want to get into it a little bit. Without, of course, without taking up too much video time. So I want to be mindful of that so I don't keep you guys here forever. But you can see here, I'm going to just create this mask here. And there's a couple different things you can do. You can create a mask. You can create a mask, or you can just cut it out here. And I think in this one here, just to be very honest, I'm just going to cut it out. I'm just going to cut it out of the picture. Let's take that over here. Give him a little bump in here. What's in this? Okay, so this part here, I'm not so sure about this here. You know what? In here, I'm not gonna go that way here. I'm actually gonna just ignore this thing as if it were straight, and you'll see why in just a second here. So let me copy this. Make the selection. I'm gonna copy this. Control C, right? And we'll come over here. We'll go to Control V. Wow, he is huge. So he's really huge. So I'm gonna reduce the size here. Press Control T or Command T if you're on a Mac. You get this these brackets around your picture. Pull the corners here, and you're gonna be able to scale it down here, like so. Yeah, so far so good. I think the next part here that I want to do, let's call this head, right? And I'm gonna just make a copy of this here. And let's make a sort of a generic piece that we can reuse for other things. So first of all, I think I'm going to just chop off his head here. And let's do this. Make a selection. Delete that. Okay, cool. This is more or less usable here. What we could do here, here's a trick here that's kind of interesting here. What you could do is you could press Control T for transform. And that allows us to make these things bigger or smaller like that. You could also go here to this is a great trick here. Use the warp tool. If you guys don't know about this here, what it does, and it used to be that it would put in these little lines here. I don't know why it's not doing that. Maybe it's a setting here. But what you have to think about here is it's dividing up this this piece here. What you could do is you could click inside here and just sort of smudge that around here, and then here you have this equivalent of like those Bezier handles here. And you can you can nudge this into place here, and so now I'm getting more or less this sort of this straight line across that shape here. And if you want, this is really great for sort of simulating perspective if you want, because you can make it look like things are getting smaller in the distance and bigger as they come at you here. So I'm just going to work with this here for now, and I think while I'm at it here, you know what, we can reconstruct some of this part here with the fin. So for that, I think I'm just going to take my lasso tool by pressing L. And this one, I don't need to be that careful here because I'm not, it's just a sort of a sloppy selection. I'm just going to take this, Control C and Control V to paste it in place. And we'll just drag this here under here. And I'm going to sort of roughly position this here with a transform to sort of make a pattern as if it's like sort of revolving around that fish here, like so. And then, you know, we can fill in the little blanks here with the stamp tool or something like that. Let's take this. I'm going to flip this vertical by right click. Here's what I did. I right clicked on the transformation, on the little transformation gizmo, and you can just right click. I'm going to flip vertical and some stuff like that, and that that does that sort of thing. So if I press enter, I can commit the change, and I sort of sew it together, I guess. I think let me just stop here, and I'm just going to just pause here for a second. All right, let's just take this here, and I think just to sort of get on with this here, let's see this. Let's merge this together here. So I've got layer 8 and this head copy here. I'm going to select this layer 8. I'm going to shift select, hold down shift, and then select this bottom layer here, head copy. And what we can do here is you can press Control E, and what Control E does is if you go here to layers, it merges those two layers together, or however many layers you have selected, it'll just sort of like reduce them all to one layer, one single layer with all of that stuff sort of recorded on it here. So if I merge the layers, all that stuff, it just becomes one here. And now with this, I think what I'm going to do, in the last video here, we talked a little bit about the Band-Aid tool, which is it's actually the healing brush. And we talked about the stamp tool. So I think I'm going to use one of these. I think I'm going to go with the stamp tool this time. And I'm just going to select a piece of this. Do be mindful here of the soft round. This is yet another one of those uses here that this thing really comes in handy. So because of the softness on the edges here. So if I select this, I'm going to hold down Alt. And we're going to click the little target here. And then we're going to just take it here. And you can see it kind of makes this other stuff here a little softer on the side here. So if we do this here, it kind of does that here, which is cool, but some of the stuff that's a little bit annoying is it gets a little too fuzzy here and it loses a little bit of precision. So, you know, that's why I always like working with patches a little more. You have a little bit more control of that. So if I just do this here a little bit, you know, you could fine tune this here to get the effect you want. So let's take this. And if you hold down Control, you can warp the perspective of it here. I think we talked about this in a previous video here. So you can get that stripe to sort of look like that. And then if anything, with that patch here, you can use the eraser tool. Press E, and again, I got my soft round brush here. And I can just soften up those parts that I don't want there, which I think I kind of do. But in any case here, like this stuff here, I don't want that. Don't want this. And there you go. So, you know, I think the rest, we can get rid of that with, say, the stamp tool. And I'm just going to keep working on this to sort of rebuild this this patch here. I'm going to pause this again and just keep working on it so I don't waste time. All right, so here I've more or less sort of patched up this piece here. I made this one generic piece here, and I was going to just copy it here and make some others, but I thought here this is actually very, very useful. Just cover up this fin, which I don't really care for that much here, but in here it's going to be kind of interesting because I can get some other uses out of this. So if I just extend this this shape out here, let's take this. I'm going to just move this over here, and we can select all the layers. I'm going to move this over here so we get a little bit of a clearer view. I can just make this thing like one long shape like that. Let's see what we got here. So this. Okay, it's snapping a little bit. One trick that you can do is you can use your little arrow tools to move this stuff around here, like so. So it's a straight line. Anyway, I've got this going on here, and let's do this. I'm going to save myself a copy of this one here, and let's merge the rest to one single thing here. See, this is all one layer, and I've got a duplicate of it up above here. But let me show you guys a trick here that's really cool. I don't know if I've shown you guys this yet. Here under layer 10, let's call this Sea Monster Body. Right. What I want to do is I want to bend it. If we look at the concept here, he's kind of doing this sort of this S curve and sort of coming out of the water here. So I think I want to do some things here. First of all, maybe we want to thin him down here somehow. So let me take my pen tool here and see what I can do here just to sort of chop some of that stuff off. Maybe let's just do that. Not bad. We can sort of shade in some of the other things here. What I'm going to do now is, like what we could do, the first thing that comes to mind, of course, is to warp this stuff here. And what's cool about the warp here is you can get some sort of like different sort of dimensions here for the the 3D shape of this. So that's one cool use of the warp tool here. However, I want to show you something that not everybody uses here, but this is kind of cool when you have like this sort of this interesting problem here where you have to have more or less like what this thing is supposed to be. It's just not in the right pose. So for that, rather than pressing Control T and finding it here, what we actually have here is you have this. Let's escape here. You have under the edit tool, you have this this tool called the puppet warp here. It's really cool because in here we can start putting a little pin in here, and let's put a little pin in here. And now you can have it do its thing here. Okay, great, right? But here's where it gets kind of interesting here. If you stick another pin in here, you see it grabs a hold of the pixels and stuff that you can see by these little lines sort of drawn around the image. This is called the mesh. So it's going to hold those things in place. And now I can take any one of these little guys here and just move this into place here. And this is really, really easy. I think the example that I did previously to show you guys, and I just decided to do it over here. I did it just by doing patches here. And so, you know, you can move that into place here. One more thing that I think I'm going to do here. So let's go back here. I'm going to press Control T. And let's see if I can make this a little smaller here, because I want his head to sort of be smaller as it gets out. The base of his neck is a little thicker here. Let's see what we get with that here. So now I'm going to go here to edit. Let's go to puppet warp and let's do that thing here. I'm going to take this. Let's put him in the water right here. Let's see if we move him out here. He's just going to be looking up, which is good, right? Like that. Sure. And then in here, we can sort of, oh yeah, that's cool, see? More or less, you gotta be careful here. You're not gonna be able to get everything here. The thing about, you know, all these Photoshop tools and digital images and stuff, it's like, you know, you have a lot of toys to play with here. It doesn't mean you have to use them all, you know? So you might not be getting, you might not get everything you want out of that one shape here, you know. So let's just keep it at this here. This is kind of cool. I mean, I could have done this a couple different ways. I mean, I could have like tediously sort of used my just copies of this to make that shape like this. So we could have done that here. All right, so the concept calls for his mouth to be open, and you know, honestly, I could probably do a better shape here with that, but this is, I don't know, it's kind of interesting too. Here's another trick. I guess just while I'm at it here, I want to address this here. So this guy's coming out of the water, right? So I think I may have mentioned this in the last video here. Water is transparent, obviously, but that's a really important detail here, because as this thing comes out of this water here, we need to see a little bit of it in the water. You can't just cut it off like this, because that just looks fake, you know. Either that, or it's really, really sort of murky water. You know, it'd be like he's coming out of paint or something. So for it to be believable as water. What I think I'm going to do here is there's several ways to do this here. I think my thinking here is I'm going to put a layer mask on it, right? And what that does here is, you know, white is the stuff you see, black is the stuff you don't see, right? So if I were to just take a paintbrush here and just run over this, you're going to see this disappear better than the paintbrush. And let me just show you what that looks like here. So I've got black selected. I'm going to click this little white square here next to the picture itself. And click this little thing here, and let's press B. I'm trying to just reduce the size of that brush. And if I were to just run over this here, you see that disappears a little bit here. And we can sort kind of like emulate that it's sort of coming out of the water here. Another trick that you can do with that that brush, let's press that again, not the brush, but with the transparency in the mask, I'm actually going to use a gradient this time. And you can see here my gradient is set to go from foreground to transparent, and not just foreground to white. Well, actually, in this case, it doesn't matter because I'm actually working with white and black, so it doesn't really matter. But I think I would rather have more control of it with just going from one color to transparent. So I'll press OK. And then on the mask itself here, I'm just going to experiment with just fading this out here. And we get this thing to disappear a little bit in the water here. So now, with some clever uses here, you could, we could put, it looks like there's something under the water here, and maybe we can put like some ripples and stuff like that. But we'll get there. Let's do this. I want to open up his mouth, and we'll start working with the mouth here. So I'm going to take my pen tool. Let's zoom in here. You know what? I think for this guy here, I'm not sure what we're going to want here. So I'm going to just do something kind of generic here. And another thing I'm noticing here is when I change the shape of his mouth here, of his head, I kind of change the shape of his eye. And I kind of want that eye, just because it's a sea creature, kind of want that eye to be big, round, big and round like a fish, you know, sort of. So I think I want it more spherical. Anyway, we'll get to that in a second here. Let's do this. I think what I'm going to do here is I'm going to make a selection, right? I'm going to copy this. And let's go back in here. Copy and paste, of course. So let's paste it on a second layer. Yeah, there we go. Let's see if we have that path selected. So if I go to paths here, that's the thing I drew with the pen tool. So if we select this, that's the shape. We still have access to it. So I'm going to use it again. Right click. Going to make selection. Let's go back to layers. This time, I'm going to go in this mask. Let's hide the original here, the layer 8. Now, this time, I'm going to go to this mask here. I'm going to take my black color and just press, hold down Alt and press Delete on the mask. And you're going to see this thing disappear, which is pretty much what we want. And then in here, I could probably just fill in the rest of this here by using my paintbrush. You see that sharp, jagged corner here? I'm going to just take this and just sort of edit that out like so. That looks okay, I guess. And now we can turn on this part here, that's the other part, and just rotate it into position. I do want to just mention here, the reason I'm doing this as a mask is because I'm not sure exactly what I'm going to need. But the nice thing about masks is I don't need to be, you know, I can go back and build this in as I go, you know. So that's the nice thing about masks here. So I'm going to use this just to try some things out. I'm going to take this bottom jaw, now that it's cut open here. And let's just move this into position here. I'm going to press Control and T. And that lets us transform things here. We can rotate that jaw like this. But what I want to do is I want to rotate it on a pivot. So I'm going to press Alt or Option if you're on a Mac. And I'm going to just drag that corner. Sometimes you see a little target, and you can drag it right about, you know, here. If you don't see it, I think that's kind of what we're doing anyways here. So I'm going to do that right here. And let's see what this gives us here. Actually, I want that sort of very sort of aggressive, sort of really big mouth like that, you know? Let's do that. That's cool. Maybe, there you go. See, yeah, that's nice and open here. Okay, maybe we can give this another mask as well, because what I want to do with this, let's take press B for brush, and what I want to do with this is, I want to erase some of this stuff here. I'm not sure what I'm going to need, but I'm going to just keep it like this. Another thing that I'm thinking of as I see this here is this is a little dark for me. So maybe in here what I could do is manipulate the curves again. So image, adjustments, and curves, like so. And let's see. Oh, you see, there you go. So it's starting to lighten up a little bit. I mean, you can play around with that. Honestly, I think what I'm missing here, depending on the perspective that we're looking at, is I think I would kind of like to see the back of his mouth here. So let's see if we can build that in with something like this. I'm going to just take this and let's do this. I'm going to just change the color of this to more of a red. Now here's a cool trick that you can do with the hue and saturation. So again, here's how I got that menu. I press Control U, right? And that brings up this. And that's the same thing as going to adjustments. Hue and saturation, and that's what this is here. It's either Control U or Command U if you're on a Mac. do this. And here's the thing. I may have shown you this tool before, and I'm not sure if I showed you the colorize option. If you check this little checkbox on, now you get it converts black and white stuff to color, and I can tell it to be a little bit more towards the reds or the blues or so on. You know, so let's point it here at the red somewhere there. And you know, if you bring it up here, it's more of a sort of pinkish, you can now just lighten it up here if you want, which I'm not going to lighten it up. I'm going to use the curves to do this here, but you can out of this you can sort of build sort of a back part for the mouth, more or less, you know, just because it has the same shape. I think that's kind of what I'm going to do, just to match it here. We can manipulate the perspective a little bit here. You see, but it's kind of important here because it gives us that sense that, you know, it's got something in the back. And now, one final thing that we can do here that's kind of interesting. You think about this as a shape. What I want in the background here is I want to put some shading in here. So here's what we're going to do. I may have talked about this before, but I'm going to use a clipping mask. So let's do this mouth. I'm going to rename this mouth back part red. I don't know. Very specific names, right? Okay, so I have this, and now we're going to shade that. And I'm going to just create a layer here. Let's call it inner mouth shading, right? Let's change this to black and white right here. And I'm going to press B for brush. And in here, let's start painting this with this. Now, if you have, I don't know, like a tablet or something, that's really, really helpful for painting this stuff here. But I'm just using my mouse here. It's not a big deal, you know? I've just painted over this stuff here, and I want to make it look like it's sort of rounder, or it's got shading to it here. So I want to contain this shape over the part here. So I'm going to take my top layer, inner mouth shape, and I'm just simply going to right click on it. Again, with the mouse, this is why it's helpful to have a mouse. You can go to create clipping mask. You can do that. I think if you don't have that, if you don't have a mouse, I mean, you could go here to edit. You could go here to, I'm sorry, not edit, but to layers. And we can do a clipping mask somewhere. Where is it? Here we go. Create clipping mask. And there's a shortcut for it too. And you can do that. And this is what a clipping mask does. So you can see here that shading that I did with the inside of the mouth. That's now, you know, that's now contained in that shape. And I can move this around, and it doesn't really alter the shape of the mouth. It just contains that shading. And the nice thing about this, and this is why I love this workflow here, is because, you know, I made that crude shape, but now I have the option of sort of like deciding, well, that's a little too dark. Let's soften it up a little bit here, and you get to work with it here. And then in addition, you know, once that's set here, I have this nice tool here with the smudge tool. It looks like a little sort of a finger, and it's kind of, that's kind of describes how you work with it. It's like messing around with oil painting, you know, and you, well, you can sort of push that those pixels around and sort of smudge them up into position. So that's kind of what I'm going to do here for the inside of the mouth. I'm going to go ahead and complete the backside here, and we'll come back and we'll do the teeth. All right, so for the teeth here, I found these this kind of interesting sort of moray eel here that I thought I would use. And what's nice about this picture here that I found is that you have these sharp teeth, these sharp, scary looking teeth against a sort of a really convenient sort of blue background. So I think the smart thing for me to do here would be just select that using the color range, and just to show you that. You know, I could just pick this here and just select it, and we can cut that out. But to make things easier for myself here, I think what I'm going to do is I'm just going to just pick out just a portion of this here. I kind of like that eye as well. You know what? Well, let's work with that eye, but I'll come back to it a little bit later. Yeah, so this is what I want right here, and I'm just going to copy a piece of it here and just paste it on a second layer. And this is all I want to deal with here. Let's go here to select. I'm going to go to color range, and we're just going to point it at the blue, like so, And then I think that's a pretty sharp selection. And we can just go in here and just press delete. And there you go. There's a little bit of blue left over. But here's kind of an interesting trick that you can use to do that here. Well, first of all, what can we do? We can probably go to the sponge tool here. For example, if I wanted to get rid of the yellow here, you know, the sponge, I don't know if I mentioned the burn and dodge tools previously, but yeah, the sponge tool, you can take color out of this here. And as I run over this here, this yellow becomes more and more sort of closer to the whites and grays and all that. So we can do that. I'm just gonna leave this alone for now. Anyway, what I wanted to show you here is to get rid of this sort of this blue outline for the shading on the teeth here. I could come down here to where it says you got this little FX button here, and that's the layer styles here. And there's all sorts of really useful things here in the layer styles. Among them is this interesting thing here for the inner shadow. So inner shadow, you can do this, and this sort of selects sort of a direction for the light. And from here, I can pick, you know, there, you can see what it does there. See, it's coming from the top, but in here, it kind of creates a sort of a little outline here. And then, you know, if you're careful with it here, you can get it sort of a little outline for, you know, for the all sorts of things here. So I'm going to just go with this here. And then I guess, let's see what that looks like. That's going to look sort of ridiculous here, but just because of the color. But let's put it on here anyway. I'm not going to work with it just like that right off the bat. Let's flip this around here, and let's see what we got here. So if I do this, I'm going to have my transform enabled, and I'm going to press Alt to position the pivot point right there. I'm going to start flipping it around there. Oh, that's kind of that actually is kind of cool right there. That is very cool actually, except for the yellow. I'm not too fond of the yellow. So maybe what we can do, let's see what we can do here. So if I press Control U. You can offset that color to some other thing here, and I think, yeah, you know what, that yellow kind of works okay. It really should be more of a something like that, you know. And then I'm gonna, yeah, there you go. If I just desaturate it, that works pretty well actually. So let's keep this here, and I don't know exactly what this is going to be about, so I might save myself an original here. So let's call this copy teeth original, right? And from here, I'm going to make some copies here. So let's hide teeth original, and I like this thing here. Let's go with this here. I'm going to just delete that part out of this, and then here I'm going to use the warp, which is kind of interesting right there. You see what it does right there. Yeah, that's super interesting there. And then we can soften this part up here, like so. Or even better, rather than erasing things, let's give him that smile here. And then here on this layer here, I'm going to use a layer mask, and we can paint it stuff back in and out using the brush. There you go. See the black brush on this thing here. So by doing this here, I can now get this this sort of this lip here to sort of fade into this here. That's a little harsh, but let's turn this down here. I'm turning down the opacity of the brush, and so that enables me to sort of do these softer strokes here. And it's just going to take some fiddling around here and just some, you know, trying things out. But I think eventually I'll get something I kind of like here. I like this, and then here I can certainly just make this a little bigger and just fade that all out here like this. And then when you combine it here with the other piece, which I'll do so in just a second. Not that. See, this is why I save originals. So here, let's take that, let's make a copy of this, hide the original, and we can just rotate this guy back into place here. Oh, this is great. See, right here. And yeah, and then we can even do two of these here. Let's do this. I'm gonna just enter this in. Let's press L for lasso. This is super cool here. I might use that for something. Let's just chop off this top part. Press delete. Wow, that's really cool, this opening here. I wonder if I can just I can just do that here, and yeah, there we go. It's just a matter of blending that into the background here now. But you know, what I'm more concerned about here with, we'll get back to that. What do you want to call it? This is the mouth corner. We'll get back to that a little bit later. What I'm mostly concerned with here is just the shape of this mouth here. So let's put this over here like so, and maybe we'll deal with that later. Okay, so I got this going here, and I might have to do some layer corrections here. So this, what I can do is I can skew it to the side here, and the way you're going to do that is if you hold down Control, you can access the little points here, and then you can sort of distort them here. But if you access the little sort of the bottom points here, you can just sort of redirect it that way here, and then, you know, here of course you can get that sort of that perspective going here. Of course, if you right click here, you can go to Warp, and you can give it sort of a curve here. I would use this very sparingly if you use the curves here. And then do remember that this thing is behind that first one here, so I'm gonna have to reorder that with the layers like so. Another thing that I might want to think about here is this thing is it's actually inside the mouth, so there's gonna be some alterations here to the lighting here. So if I go to Image, Adjustments, and Curves, that's Control M, right? There you go. You see that? That sort of darkens it down, so it looks like this piece is behind that. It's still not the right color I want, but it's more or less the right lighting. Let's see what we got here. Yeah. All right. So this is why you want to keep stuff. Or there you go. So that's all. All this is the bottom piece, and I might want to rotate this just a tad more. There you go. See, like that. Rotate that little tad more. And what about this? Yeah, I think I could fit that that part in here. Well, let me see if I can do something about this this color. It's kind of bothering me in the yellow. There we go. So something more like that. And then if we just desaturate it so it's a little pinkish. Same thing with this. I don't know that I like that either. Oh, that's cool. Anyway, I'm going to play around here with the colors, and we can sort of merge all this together. All right, so I just was just sort of working on this on my own, and you can see I'm sort of fixing this up here. Thought of something cool, and I thought I would just take some time to address this here. So I thought of giving him some tentacles, you know, kind of like a catfish or something, just coming out of the neck or the mouth and things. So I think I looked up some pictures of catfish and stuff. And actually, this stuff is sort of hard to just cut out of the picture. So this is usually something I talk about with in sort of these painting classes and stuff. But I thought it'd be kind of interesting to talk about it here. And it's a little bit, you know, I don't know. It's not really advanced or anything, but you know, we might as well just get into it here. So check this out. So what I actually did, so this is something I was playing around with here too. My thinking was, well, maybe I can just take one of these octopus things here and just sort of select them from here, and then use the puppet warp to sort of make them, you know, wrap around however I want. And you could do that, but it's a lot of trouble just to sort of really select all that stuff out here. I didn't feel like doing that, and that's not quite the look I want for this creature anyway. So my first approach here was this. So this here, as I drew this line myself in Photoshop here using the brush features here, and I'll show you how to do that in just a second. And then, you know, and then I used some of the brushes here. Let me show you which ones I was working with here. So all it is, it's really just this, and then a brush that looks like this that sort of splatters these little spots, this little coloration over it here. And that's all that is. However, I would kind of have to do a custom one for each one, and I thought I would get into just showing you a sort of a smarter way of working here with what you call smart objects here. So smart objects is very, very interesting in terms of all sorts of things, you know, graphics related and stuff. What a smart object is, it's an instance. That means, like, it's a copy that's like linked to the original. And so if I decide to change something, then it carries over across all the changes, and the order of the changes, it affects how it looks. So I know that's sort of abstract here. Let's go ahead and make one here. So you may not know about this feature either here, but I'm simply, rather than doing this nice curvy line here, I'm just gonna just create just a really simple, just a straight line, just like that, okay? And I'm gonna pick a brush here. Let's go to B for brush, and let's go to this hard round one here. Oh, you know what? You know why it's not showing up? It's because I need a layer. So I'm gonna press this little button here to create a layer. And that's a really big brush here. I'm gonna just shrink this down like so. And let's pick a color that represents the coloration of this creature here. So I'm gonna go with this here. So I'm gonna hold down Alt and just select a little sample from that part of the skin. And now here's a feature that you guys may not know about just yet. I'm gonna get this brush to trace along that line. Big deal so far, but there's this kind of this interesting feature that I'm looking for in the trace that sort of thins out the tips of these tentacles here. So up above here, you have some features here. These are going to be very, very useful if you're working with a pen to make things, say, transparent. When you press harder, it makes things more opaque. If you press lighter, it makes it more transparent. And over here, you have something that makes your line bigger when you press harder on your pen, if you're using a tablet or something like that. I'm gonna go ahead and turn this one on, even though I'm not working with the tablet, because I'm gonna show you a feature that it has. So now, you know, now my Photoshop knows about pressure sensitivity, okay? So if I right click on this here, we can use this command, stroke path, and this is a really great command because you can do all sorts of useful things. So right now I'm only interested in drawing and tracing with a brush, but you can see I can assign it to any tool I want here, really. Let's just go with a brush, and I'll press OK. And this is important, simulate pressure. So that means like it's going to apply this sort of this automatic setting where, you know, typically as people draw, you start light and then you get thicker or harder as you're in the middle of the stroke, and then you lift your pencil off the paper and it gets thinner again. So that's what this is all about here, simulating that pressure, just using that simple idea there. And I'm going to go ahead and press it here, and we're going to get this effect, you see? So all that is, it's really just this brush, you know, with the simulated pressure, and it thins out towards the end. And I don't even care about this part anymore. Let's go ahead, and I'm going to just delete this this line here for now. Let's go and apply an inner shadow to this. And if we apply an inner shadow, I like this a lot, but, you know, just to show you, you can change it, you know, you can make it more like that, so on, just to make things a little bit more exciting. What else can we do? Let's give it some coloration. So I'm going to pick a sample that represents the color, and let's go back to that interesting splatter brush that I had here, and I'm just going to just lay that over there. Oh, that's cool, yeah. Let's make it a little smaller. There we go. You know what? I think I need some orange in here. Do I need some orange? Let's put some orange in there. There we go. There. All right, cool. Oh, wait. Oh, my bad. All right, so my apologies. I did that on the wrong layer. So here, I want to put this on top here. So let's go ahead and just do a layer of that. Let's point it at the red this time. Give it a little bit of that and maybe a little bit of this. Come on. Let's talk about red. There we go. There. Awesome. Cool. That's what I'm looking for. All right. So I've got layer 9 for these specs and this base layer, which is the sort of the white tentacle. Let's take layer 9. I'm going to make it, let's apply some sort of blend mode. I'm going to just tone it down a little bit. Or, maybe it was a little too intense with that, but maybe what we can do here with this is let's give it, let's give it a mask. And here, I'm going to just fade, there we go. See, if you start fading it out here a little bit, it gets a little lighter at the end here. Let's just bring this back, make it stronger here towards the middle. Let me see. That does the trick right there. Yeah, you know what? What I don't like about this is just the colors, you know? But this mostly works, you know? All right, so here's the thing, okay? Now, you can do this two different ways. You can merge this. I'm going to put this in a folder. So I like all this stuff here. And just to show you what I'm talking about here, I'm intentionally leaving this sort of, because I want to do some changes later just to show you what this is about. Let's call this thing Smart Tentacle. And I'm going to right-click on this. And up here, I'm going to convert this to a smart object. And all right, now you see everything went away and it feels like it's one layer and you have this little icon right here on the layer. And that means it's like it's linked to something here. With this, I can do all sorts of stuff here. I'm going to go to Edit and let's go to Puppet Warp. You know what? Before we do that, cancel. Let's just not do that. Here, just stop. Escape. Let's do something here. Smart Tentacle. Let's put a little gradient on it, right? So with a gradient, I'm going to fade this out there. Yeah, you know what? That's a little too much. Let's do a gradient here, and I'm going to fade it out with the brush. So B for brush. Let's give that this, and let's just fade that out right there. There you go. All right, so there we go. I'm going to do this, make this bigger. There we go. All right, cool. That's exactly what I want. And now with this, now that I have this, I can go to Edit. Let's go to Puppet Warp. Right? Puppet Warp. What am I doing here? Oh, of course. Of course it's not giving me that because I had this selected. Let's go back here to this. Edit. There we are. Puppet Warp. And here, you know, just like we did the snake itself here, we can just bring this back. Oh, okay. And this, excuse me, guys. Here, I unlinked this here. Let's bring this back here, over here. And I want to make sure this is linked. Let's go to Edit, Puppet Warp. Huh. And I can do all sorts of stuff like this. All right, cool. So I press Enter. That's done. And you know, we can take. Excuse me. Yeah, you know what I meant to do here. I meant to make more copies. So let's take this one, and I'll show you what I'm talking about here. Now let's go Edit, Puppet Warp. I'll just put one in here, here, and here. Okay, great. All right, so there we have this one coming out like that. Let's take this other one here and let's put that one up on top. Let's make another copy while we're at it. And edit Puppet Warp. There you go. And so on. Let's make one more here, and I'll show you what these are all about. I don't think I'm going to complete this thing just right now, but just to show you what these tentacles are about, I can put another one right here. Let's pinch this one down a little bit. We can even darken this one up a little bit more. And yeah, and that's great. That's really great, actually. Yeah, I like that. Let's go here to Edit, Puppet, come on, Edit, Puppet Warp, and we can do one here, here, there you go. Just enter, and you have that. Okay, so now what about the smart objects here? So here's the interesting thing about the smart object here. You know, I decided, I really like this one and the lighting and stuff. But I think that here, I kind of miss a little sort of like a sort of a little shine to make this thing 3D. So what I could do is I could just jump into the smart tentacle here. Let's double click this layer, right? And watch, it's missing shine on all of them here. So I'm gonna double click this. We can go back inside here. You see it opens up another another document within Photoshop. So it's like having a document within a document here. And now, if I open up this folder, just like I had it originally, there's all my stuff. So I can decide, you know what, I don't want the spots anymore. Just turn it off and save and things. In fact, let me just show you. I'll just save this. And let's jump back here to the picture. Where are we? And they're gone. You see? Let's go back and turn them back on. Control S to save, and there they are again. Okay, cool. So now in here, I think I'm just gonna go in here and just add another layer of lighting. And let's take this brush, get a nice sort of soft round brush. And I'm just, I could trace with the pen tool, but I think I'm just gonna just drag this. You know what? I'll trace with the pen tool. Do this here, here, just a straight line, stroke, right click, stroke path. Let's simulate the pressure, and there it is. Oops, oh, yeah, you know what? Here, I was doing that on that layer. Let's make a new layer. Now, we'll do stroke path. Simulate pressure with a brush. There we go, that's cool. All right, and if it's not exactly what you need, you could always just sort of pinch it down here. Maybe even warp it out a little bit here, sort of, you know, to get this into shape like that. That's cool. And then here, if this is too intense for you, you could just, tone it down a little bit. Let's save it here. I like this. I like where this is going here. And I'm just going to save it here. Control S. Let's go back in here. And there you go. You got some shine on all of them all at once. And that's what smart objects are all about. All right, so moving along here, you can see I've added some more tentacles and stuff, and I went ahead and added some interesting fins or whatever, if you will. And here is how I did that. Let me see. Here we are. So I found this picture of this interesting sort of Japanese betta fighting fish, and I'm really interested in these fins here that he has. And I just want to show you a sort of technique to just select this stuff. And not have to trace over everything and get a really nice selection. So this guy is over sort of a mostly sort of a white background. So what I did here is I took a copy of this layer and let's just duplicate it here, right? And let's just pretend this is it. So I'm gonna go and just remove all the color out of this. So you can do Shift Control and U or Shift Command U. And that's the same thing as going to Adjustments. And that's desaturate, which also is the same thing as just going here to saturation by hand, and then just dialing all the saturation or the color out of this picture. So with this with this in place here, next I'm going to go to the levels. So Control L again, right? Control L or Command L, and I'm going to just sort of dial up the black. Compress the white here, and you can see everything is just becoming like more contrasting here, like so. So I think I like this, and I'm going to just fill in the blanks here with the brush, and we can just this is kind of interesting here. I've got some sort of if you want transparency, you can keep that here, but then you're gonna have to address how transparent you want it. So if I run over this with sort of a black brush at a 42% opacity, for example, then you can see it's more or less transparent. All right, so that the idea is that. So why am I creating this this silhouette here when we want this whole thing with a fish? Well, this is garbage. I'm not gonna use this. I'm gonna throw it away. What I'm gonna do here is I'm gonna go to selection, color range, and we can just grab the color here in the background, press OK, like so. And with that in place here, all we have to do is just go back to layer one. Let's grab this again. Let's see. Right, here we are. So turn that back on and simply just delete the background here. you have yourself a fish with, you know, the transparency and all that stuff just like you wanted here. So here, I'm going to just bring that guy into the sea monster picture here. And what I'm simply going to do is I'm going to use the parts that I'm interested in using here from this fish, and which are just the fins. And he has a lot of interesting fins to work with here. So I'm going to play around with this on my own, but just to show you what I was doing here, if you create a mask for this here, you can hide the parts that you don't want. And so, for example, if I take my brush, I can just make it bigger. And let's say we're just interested in this fin here. Just paint this guy out here. You know, just paint all that stuff out here, and it's not set in stone. You can always go back and sort of, you know, change it stuff. So like, you know, if you wanted just to work with this fin here, and you don't have to be so like meticulous with the mask here, because I mean, you know, at the end of the day, you're only going to see part of this. It doesn't have to be, you know, you don't have to worry too much about some of the stuff in here, because if it's hidden behind the monster anyway, then you're not going to see it here. So, you know, just be smart about like how you're going about hiding these things here, and you can get yourself some pretty sort of interesting effects with this. All right, so just to finish this off here, I'm playing around with some sort of final effects here with like him lifting out of the water. And we're gonna see a splash and stuff. And so, you know, how did I do that? And I am not going to create a splash by myself. I guess you could and stuff, but it would be kind of hard. So I thought of similar things, making that effect in the water. And the thing that came to mind, I think the search term I first used was like a killer whale. And I didn't come across a killer whale, but just whales. You know, well, here is a killer whale, actually. So this is kind of cool because, you know, as it sort of dives back into the water, it takes some of the water with it, and it makes this kind of this hole in the water a little bit. You know, so that was kind of an interesting shape of the water. What else? There were all sorts of stuff like this. This is cool. You see how it sort of splashes around. I didn't notice this one, but that might be interesting, too. So I used a couple of them here. Let's see. Let me just cut to the chase here and show you what I have. You know, this one's really great. This is great. You see, it's got all this sort of that white foam that here. And so the only thing I don't really need is just that tail here. And all you really have to do is create a mask for that and just mask it out. And that's exactly what I did here. I used two different layers. So here it is. Well, that's the final one. This is the original killer whale one, where it's sort of pushing the water down. I got sort of an interesting effect here, but it wasn't exactly what I wanted. So I overlaid it with one that works a little better. And from here, I'll keep adding on to this. I'm not done yet, but you know, I think I'm going to keep it at this for this video because it's getting a little long. And here, what I think I'm going to do, though, you know, here's another idea that you can do. I'm going to add another layer here on top, and let's add some splashes here with one of these splatter brushes or something like that. It doesn't have to be a splatter brush. You can find something that you like that has a sort of a similar effect. And I'm just going to make something here with this. Let's see what we got here just with that. Yeah, that's cool. See, that's pretty cool. Let's do this just for this. Let's call this splash. And don't mind the spelling. So let's do that. What else? I guess you can do that in the same way that I did the cloud earlier here. And if we take, say, our burn and dodge tools here, you know, you can, that's a little tedious here, but I was thinking that you could apply some shadows and stuff. I don't know that I care about this too much, just to go through all that little detail here. I think there's a better way of doing that here. So let's turn this back up, and I'm just going to just reduce the size of this here a little bit here. And this is all sort of, but I mean, yeah, there you go. So I mean, that small here, it looks like it's just part of the it looks like it's just part of the splash here. And this guy just sort of pushed, you know, he was just creating that splash. So you could take some interesting effects here and combine them with combine them with the photographs and stuff and get exactly what you want, more or less. So that's kind of how I did the splash. You may notice here from the last time I showed you here that I've added a little bit of light to him here, and that was done this way here. Here I've actually put the whole body in its own layer, and let's do this from scratch. So this is the body here, and on top of the body, I just picked a color that sort of roughly represents the tone of the color on this thing, because his color is a little off here. It feels he's a little bit more to the blue, where it's like you have like a sort of an afternoon sort of lighting on this ship here. And so I'm going to pick something that resembles that a little bit, maybe even more to the orange or to the red. And let's go and just paint right over this here with, let's say, the general brushes. Let's take the soft round. And on here, to tell you the truth, to be very honest, I think it would be smarter for me to do one over this so it catches the tentacles as well, because with the body here, it's only going to catch the body. But anyway, I'm just going to do something like this and sort of roughly sort of paint it in kind of where I would think the lighting hits it here. You know, just looking at this as well, if we think about how the light contours this object, this is a three-dimensional form. There's some light that's going to roll off here. So I can use the, for example, the smudge brush here to sort of push things like that out of the way. And, you know, of course, if I had a sort of a more interesting shape, then you could totally use this to sort of refine some of that stuff here, you see? So anyway, that's what's going on here with this. And, you know, finally, just to sort of finish this off, I'm going to play around with the blend modes here. So for example, I think the overlay actually works really nice. Another one you could work with here is the multiply. Multiply tends to darken things up a little bit. So depending on what you're going for, it might not be the effect you want here, but overlay, soft light, or something like that, it tends to be very, very subtle. And you can just use that to sort of color in some of the tone that you want, or even lighting. You know, if we wanted to add shading and things like that, you can with black and white as well. You know, just like I did the tentacles, we could do a sort of a layer of white. And that's pretty much more or less what I have for as far as the techniques and things. I probably have to do some cleaning up here, but that's kind of more or less what I had in mind here for this this photo montage. So yeah, that's pretty much it. I hope you enjoyed, and let me know if you have questions. Thank you.